The Passion of Our Lord according to St. Mark. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany near the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples and said to them,
"Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' say this, 'The Lord needs it, and we'll send it back here immediately.'"
As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them,
"What are you doing, untying the colt?"
They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who sent ahead and those who followed, shouting, It was 2 days before the Passover and the festival of unleavened bread. The chief priests and the scribes were looking for a way to arrest Jesus by stealth and kill him, for they said,
"Not during the festival, or there will be a riot among the people."
Then Judas Iscariot, who was one of the 12, went to the chief priest in order to betray Jesus to them. When they heard it, they were greatly pleased and promised to give him money. So he began to look for an opportunity to betray him. On the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb is sacrificed, his disciples said to him,
"Where do you want us to go and make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?"
So he sent two of his disciples, saying to them,
Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him. And wherever he enters, say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks, where is my guest room, where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large room upstairs, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there."
So the disciples set out and went to the city and found everything as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, he came with the 12. And when they had taken their places and were eating, Jesus said,
"Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me."
They began to be distressed and to say to him one after another,
"Surely not I."
He said to them,
"For the Son of Man goes as it is written of him, but woe to the one whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one to not have been born.
While they were eating, he took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, gave it to them, and said,
"Take, this is my body."
Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, and all of them drank from it. He said to them,
"This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I tell you, I will never again drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God."
When they had sung the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives, and Jesus said to them,
"You will all become deserters, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered.' But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee."
Peter said to him,
"Even though all become deserters, I will not."
Jesus said to him,
"Truly I tell you, this day, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times."
But he said vehemently,
"Even though I must die with you, I will not deny you."
And all of them said the same. They went to a place called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples,
"Sit here while I pray."
He took with him Peter and James and John, and began to be distressed and agitated. And he said to them,
"I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake."
And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. He said,
"Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Remove this cup from me, yet not what I want, but what you want."
He came and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter,
"Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep awake for an hour? Keep awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak.
And again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to say to him. He came a third time and said to them,
Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Enough, the hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of the sinners. Get up, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand.
Immediately, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. And with him there was a crowd with swords and clubs, from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying,
One of you kisses the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard.
So when he came, he went up to him at once and said, Rabbi, and kissed him. Then they laid hands on him and arrested him. But one of those who stood near drew his sword and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to them,
Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a bandit? Day after day, I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But let the scriptures be fulfilled.
All of them deserted and fled. A certain young man was following him, wearing nothing but a linen cloth. They caught hold of him, but he left the linen cloth and ran off naked. They took Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes were assembled. Peter had followed him at a distance, right into the courtyard of the high priest, and he was sitting with the guards, warming himself at the fire. Now the chief priests and the whole council were looking for testimony against Jesus to put him to death, but they found none. For many gave false testimony against him, and their testimony didn't agree. Some stood up and gave false testimony against him, saying,
We heard him say, I will destroy this temple that is made with hands, and in 3 days I will build another not made with hands.
But even on this point, their testimony did not agree. Then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus,
Have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you?
He was silent and did not answer. Again, the high priest asked him,
Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?
Jesus said,
I am, and you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven.
Then the high priest tore his clothes and said,
Why do we still need witnesses? You have heard his blasphemy. What is your decision?
All of them condemned him as deserving death. Some began to spit on him, to blindfold him, and to strike him, saying, "Prophesy." The guards also took him over and beat him. While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the serving girls of the high priest came by. When she saw Peter warming himself, she stared at him and said, "You also were with Jesus, the man from Nazareth." But he denied it, saying,
"I do not know or understand what you are talking about."
And he went out into the forecourt. Then the cock crowed. And the servant girl, on seeing him, began again to say to the bystanders, "This man is one of them." But again he denied it. Then, after a little while, the bystanders again said to Peter, "Certainly you are one of them, for you are a Galilean." But he began to curse, and he swore an oath.
"I do not know this man you are talking about."
At that moment, the cock crowed for the second time. Then Peter remembered that Jesus had said to him,
"Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times."
And he broke down and wept. As soon as it was morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate asked him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
He answered him,
"You say so."
Then the chief priests accused him of many things. Pilate asked him again,
"Have you no answer? See how many charges they bring against you?"
But Jesus made no further reply, so that Pilate was amazed. Now at the festival, he used to release a prisoner for them, anyone for whom they asked. Now a man called Barabbas was in prison with the rebels who had committed murder during the insurrection. So the crowd came and began to ask Pilate to do for them according to his custom. Then he answered them,
"Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?"
For he realized that it was out of jealousy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate spoke to them again.
"Then what do you wish me to do with the man you call the king of the Jews?"
They shouted back, "Crucify him!" Pilate asked them,
"Why? What evil has he done?"
But they shouted all the more, "Crucify him!" So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas for them. And after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers led him into the courtyard of the palace, that is, the governor's headquarters. And they called together the whole cohort, and they clothed him in a purple cloak. And after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him, and they began saluting him.
"Hail, King of the Jews!"
They struck his head with a reed, spat upon him, and knelt down in homage to him. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him. They compelled a passerby who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. It was Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus.
Sacred and now undone.
Then they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. And they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he didn't take it. And they crucified him and divided his clothes among them, casting lots to decide what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And with him, they crucified two bandits, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying,
"Oh, you who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross."
In the same way, the chief priests, along with the scribes, were also mocking him among themselves and saying,
"He saved others, he cannot save himself. Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now, so that we may see and believe."
Those who were crucified with him also taunted him. When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud voice,
"Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani,"
which means,
my God, why have you forsaken me?"
When some of the bystanders heard it, they said,
"Listen, he's calling for Elijah."
And someone ran, filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink, saying,
"Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down."
Then Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Now when the centurion who stood facing him saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said,
"Truly, this man was the Son of God."
Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there? Were you
There were also women looking on from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, and Mary, the mother of James the younger, and of Joseph, and Salome. These used to follow him and provided for him when he was in Galilee. And there were many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem. When evening had come, and since it was the day of preparation, that is, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a respected member of the council, who was also himself waiting expectantly for the kingdom of God, went boldly to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate wondered if he were already dead, and summoning the centurion, he asked him whether he had been dead for some time. When he learned from the centurion that he was dead, he granted the body to Joseph. Then Joseph got a linen cloth, and taking down the body, wrapped it in the linen cloth and laid it in a tomb that had been hewn out of the rock. He then rolled a stone against the door of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, saw where the body was laid.
Relying on the promises of God, we pray boldly for the church, the world, and all in need. In Jesus, you came among us as a suffering servant. Give your church humility, redeem your people from pride and the certainty that we always know your will. Heal us and empower us to confess Christ crucified. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. In creation, life springs from death. Redeem your creation awaiting resurrection. Restore lost habitats and endangered species. Create new possibilities for areas affected by climate change. Grant relief from natural disasters and nurture new growth. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Jesus was handed over to the powers of this world. In all nations, instruct the powerful that they would not employ the power but maintain justice. Sustain soldiers and guide those who command them, that they serve those in greatest need. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. On the cross, Jesus joined all who feel forsaken. Abide with those who are condemned to death. Defend those who are falsely accused. Console and strengthen those who are mocked or bullied. Accompanying all who suffer, especially we pray for homebound Ray, Kristen, Pat, Maybeth, Mary Lou, Joanne, Marge. We also pray for Pastor Bishop, Judy C., Judy M., Ed U., Linda E., Carolyn L., William S., Matt F., Marie M., Beth P., Janet R., Deb R., Darlene C., Sue M. For all who are facing coronavirus, those receiving care from Stephen Ministries, and those we now name either silently or aloud, grant respect and renewal. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. You called followers to tend Jesus's body in death. Sustain hospice workers and funeral directors. Bless this congregation's ministries at times of death. Those who plan and lead funerals, those who prepare meals, all who offer support in grief. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. We rejoice in the baptisms and we rejoice in the baptismal anniversary of Jan Dobbins, Bill Matajesic, Nancy Kyle, Jeanette Schaefer, Carolyn Lamb, and Dennis Mahalo. We thank you for the youth in this congregation and community, especially today for Adam Gerber. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. You inspired the centurion to confess Jesus as your son. We praise you for the faith you have given to people of all places and times. Give us also such faith to trust the promises of baptism and with them to look for the resurrection of the dead. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. We entrust ourselves and all our prayers to you, O faithful God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
This year for Palm Passion Sunday, we thought that we would try something different as a way to tell the complete story from Palm Sunday all the way through to the crucifixion. And so I'd like to especially thank our readers, Jerry and Phyllis, for working with me as we figured out how to do all that. Lots of thanks are also in order for all of the leaders who are helping to prepare our other Holy Week services. We will have worship on Maundy Thursday, this Thursday, on Zoom only. That will be at 7 p.m. and it will include Holy Communion as we recall the gift of the Lord's Supper, which helps us to face difficult times. Then, for Good Friday, worship will be recorded and available on YouTube as we remember the story of how Jesus died, and then we respond in grateful prayer for the world that God loves so much. Then, on Sunday, Easter Sunday, we will celebrate as best we can with a recorded service on YouTube and the regular 10 a.m. service on Zoom. There will be communion at that service as well. For more information, you can check your email newsletter. As always, if you're not getting the email newsletter yet, you can sign up at trinityvermilion.org. You are what God made you to be, created in Christ Jesus for good works, chosen as holy and beloved, freed to serve your neighbor. God bless you that you may be a blessing. In the name of the holy and life-giving Trinity, amen. Go in peace, share the good news. Thanks be to God.